Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Homo Mysterious, Evolutionary Puzzles of Human Nature, by David P. Barash, narrated by Joe Barrett. Chapter 1. In Praise of Mystery. That's how the light gets in. Mystics exult in mystery and want it to stay mysterious. Scientists exult in mystery for a different reason. It gives them something to do. Richard Dawkins. We are surrounded by mysteries. Indeed, mysteries are us. There are more things in human biology than are dreamt of in our philosophy, or, more to the point, known by our science. But don't get the wrong idea, Horatio. Mystery is not the same as mysticism, and Homo Mysterious does not refer to some sort of ineffable, spiritualistic claptrap beyond the reach of natural law or human understanding. Just as a weed is a plant that hasn't yet been assigned a value, the mysteries we shall encounter in Homo Mysterious, such biological oddities as female orgasm, prominent non-lactating breasts, advanced consciousness, the origins of religious faith, and the making of art, are simply scientific questions waiting for answers. It was a stroke of brilliance as well as immodesty when our species named itself Homo sapiens, usually translated as man the wise. A better rendering, however, would probably have been the knowing, since human beings seem more effective at accumulating knowledge than wisdom, although it can be hoped that the former will lead eventually to the latter. In any event, there is no doubt that our collective store of knowledge has been increasing dramatically and that science is largely responsible. At the same time, there is also no doubt that plenty remains to be learned. Although some people gesture toward what has been called the end of science, the notion that all the big questions have been answered, mission accomplished, redux, leaving us with mere mopping up operations, the reality is that there is an awful lot that we still do not know. And ironically, we Homo sapiens are both subject and object of much of that unknowing. Know thyself? Easier said than done. Moreover, at the risk of descending into cliché, the more we know, the more we discover how much remains to be learned. Far from discouraging, I hope this will be seen as both a reward for past accomplishments and, no less, a challenge to do more. Who wants to listen to a book about a topic when science has already closed the book on it? Most books about science are just that, accounts of what has already been learned. This one is different. It's about mysteries, what we don't know. Yet. The Collins International Dictionary, 2003, defines mystery as an unexplained or inexplicable event, phenomenon, etc., which seems reasonable enough until you think about it. For an event or phenomenon to be unexplained is one thing, but to be inexplicable is quite another. If something is truly inexplicable, it is beyond the possible reach of human understanding and therefore likely to fit a theological rather than a scientific definition of mystery, something unknowable except through divine revelation, such as how wine is, mysteriously, turned into the literal blood of Christ during the Eucharist. Let me lay my cards on the table here and now. I do not believe in theological mysteries, or rather, I believe that they are simply ways of clothing meaninglessness in gobbledygook. Homo Mysterious, therefore, will not be concerned with the inexplicable, but rather with the unexplained, with things about human beings that are currently unknown, but that fall within the potential reach of science. After all, the real world poses genuine mysteries aplenty, that is, puzzles that are not yet susceptible to understanding, but that we can be confident will be brought to heel sometime in the future. Science, of course, is in the business of doing just this, answering questions about the natural world, Homo sapiens included. And since nature does not disclose its secrets readily, scientists are understandably proud whenever they solve any of its numerous puzzles. As a result, we teach courses, give lectures, and occasionally write books whose goal is to share these triumphs. They are, after all, hard-won and often immensely useful. No one, therefore, should begrudge us taking a victory lap now and then. But just as the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 11, the cheers of the crowd do not always bespeak that the race is over or the battle won. I have been teaching science courses at the college and university level for 40 years, and am no less guilty than my colleagues of providing what may well be a misleading perspective on science. Like everyone else, I teach what is known, often at the risk of misleading students into thinking that today's science is a catalog of established and comprehended facts. This is how cells metabolize carbohydrates. This is how natural selection works. This is how the information encoded in DNA is translated into proteins. The reality, of course, is that we do know quite a bit about how cells metabolize carbohydrates, how natural selection works, and so forth. But another parallel reality is that there is much more that we do not know, and very few courses that admit it. One of these days, I will design a course titled something like, What We Don't Know About Biology, hoping that my colleagues in chemistry, physics, geology, mathematics, psychology, and the like will join the fun. But until then, this book will have to do. It is, in a sense, a companion piece to a much more famous publication, or rather a series of 17 volumes, first published in France between 1751 and 1765, and best known as the Encyclopédie, which endeavored to summarize all human knowledge in its 18,000 pages of text, 75,000 different entries, and 20 million words. Its primary editor, Denis Diderot, was one of the heroes of the Enlightenment, and indeed the Encyclopédie represents a culmination of Enlightenment thought, which valued reason, science, and progress, what we know, above all else. Its frontispiece is especially delightful. Depicting truth, surrounded by a bright light, the traditional symbol of the Enlightenment itself, as an attractive young woman being disrobed by reason and natural philosophy, that is, science. The illustration is more than a bit erotic, as truth is revealed to be both alluring and accessible, albeit appropriately shy. Just as Diderot's Encyclopédie was a paean to Enlightenment values, notably the upside of human knowledge, Homo Mysterious is similarly enamored of reason, science, and progress, even though it is superficially dissimilar, and not merely because its goals and reach are much more limited. Nonetheless, in Homo Mysterious, we shall continue the tradition of the Encyclopédie's frontispiece, attempting to get a closer look at truth, but instead of undressing her, we shall proceed non-voyeuristically, pointing out where, despite the best efforts of reason and science, she continues to be at least somewhat clothed. All women, oh, are beautiful, wrote Theodore Retke, when they are half undressed. The same applies to truth itself. Unlike the Encyclopédie, which took all knowledge as its subject, in Homo Mysterious we shall limit ourselves to human beings. Not only that, we'll be concerned only with certain characteristics of Homo sapiens as seen through the lens of evolutionary biology. The traits in question are fundamental to being human, stubborn stigmata of our species' unique evolutionary heritage, yet their basis is neither understood by scientists nor, for the most part, even acknowledged by the public as the puzzles that they are. Most people are unaware that female orgasm, for example, and even religion, are biological mysteries simply because nearly everyone takes the most intimate aspects of his or her life for granted, so deeply woven into our substantive human being that they are rarely identified as legitimate perplexities. We members of Homo sapiens are almost literally immersed in mystery. The evolutionary enigmas of humankind are the seas in which we swim. In Homo Mysterious, you will be introduced to this ocean of unknowns, as well as to the major hypotheses that currently occupy scientists who are attempting to unravel each puzzle, including some proposed here for the first time. Like science courses, nearly all science books describe what we know, thereby giving the impression that we know nearly everything, whereas the reality is exactly the opposite. We know very little, compared to how much we don't. Homo Mysterious is designed for listeners likely to be challenged by the blank spots on the human evolutionary map, the terra incognita of our own species. At the risk of channeling former Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld, there are unknown unknowns, things we don't understand and that we don't even know that we don't know. Since we can't identify them, unknown unknowns are difficult, perhaps impossible, to write about. On the other hand, there are also known unknowns, things that we don't yet understand, but that we at least have the wisdom to acknowledge as such. Prior to Albert Einstein, Niels Bohr, Enrico Fermi, and others, nuclear energy was a known unknown, just as evolution was before Darwin. Today, the underlying basis for homosexuality is similarly a mystery, a phenomenon whose scientific basis is unknown, as is consciousness, the cross-cultural universality of religious belief, the evolutionary basis of artistic creativity, and so forth. Homo Mysterious will examine these and other perplexities from a perspective that many listeners will find unusual. Thus, we shall be less concerned with how these things come about than with why. Not why in the metaphysical sense, but that of evolutionary biologists. Were we to ask how people became bipedal, the answer would involve changes in muscle attachments, bone structure, and nerve growth. To be concerned instead with the evolutionary why is to ask about the likely adaptive pressures that must have conveyed a reproductive advantage to those of our ancestors who walked on two legs, regardless of exactly how that posture was achieved. Similarly, we'll be concerned less with how religious belief or homosexuality comes about, the nerves, muscles, brain regions, hormones, or specific genes responsible, than with why these behaviors, regardless of their underlying mechanisms, appeared and have persisted in the human population despite their seeming evolutionary disadvantages. This approach is familiar to evolutionary biologists, and less so to most anatomists, physiologists, and the intelligent lay public as well. Not that scientists aren't likely to be evolutionary in their thinking, rather they are more prone to ask questions, and to answer them, in terms of immediate causal mechanisms. Instead, we'll raise questions, and answer them, in evolutionary terms. The underlying conceptual theme is, therefore, in what way has female orgasm, concealed ovulation, homosexuality, consciousness, religious belief, etc., contributed to the ultimate reproductive success of human beings, thus in all likelihood explaining why this particular trait evolved. One way of conceptualizing this process is to think about what is sometimes called reverse engineering. In normal engineering, a problem is identified, after which some sort of device or structure is engineered as a solution. Reverse engineering operates, not surprisingly, in reverse. A device or structure, or in the case of Homo Mysterious, a behavior, is identified, after which the evolutionary biologist tries to figure out how this particular phenomenon came to be engineered, which is to say, why it evolved. In many cases, the process is straightforward and obvious, so that it is rarely even attempted. Why do we love our children? Almost certainly, ancestors who lacked parental love didn't do a very good job of caring for their offspring, and therefore didn't become ancestors. In that sense, love may actually be less mysterious than is generally thought. For all its storied and supposedly enigmatic nature, there are other human characteristics far more mysterious than love. Once we identify them, we are faced with the question of reverse engineering them. In nearly every such case, we will identify multiple potential evolutionary explanations, although we'll refrain from coming up with the explanation, simply because at this point, despite the world's impressive store of accumulated scientific knowledge, final answers just aren't yet available. Hence the mystery, the pleasure, and eventually the illumination. "There's a crack in everything," writes poet-songwriter Leonard Cohen. "That's how the light gets in." Just one modification. There are many cracks. And when it comes to some of the most interesting mysteries of human evolution, no reason why a single one should necessarily provide the only illumination. Homo Mysterious, therefore, cannot claim to be exhaustive, just scientifically accurate as far as it goes, and, I hope, fun. Consistent with our slightly lascivious reflections on the frontispiece to the Encyclopédie, we'll begin our exploration with some human sexual mysteries. Then we move above the waist. I hope you enjoy the trip and that along the way, you might even come up with a suggestion or two that could help solve some of the evolutionary mysteries we're about to explore together. Chapter 2. Sexual Mysteries 1. Menstruation, Concealed Ovulation, and Breasts. Most people would agree that sex is a mystery, but they would probably be thinking of romantic perplexities rather than scientific enigmas. The fact is, however, that when Winston Churchill famously described Russia in 1939 as a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma, he could as well have been speaking of some hardwired aspects of human sexuality. Particularly mysterious, at least from the perspective of evolutionary biology, are some aspects of the sexual biology of women. The first notable mystery begins when a girl becomes a woman, menstruation. Although a few other species bleed slightly at mid-cycle, no other organism does so as prominently as Homo sapiens. Breast development is another perplexity. Although we take it for granted that women have conspicuous breast tissue, even when not nursing, no other mammal is comparably bosomed. Only human beings are blessed, or in the opinion of some, cursed, with prominent, non-lactating breasts. The mysteries continue. Go to a zoo and take a look at the chimpanzees, gorillas, or baboons, or indeed nearly any non-human primate. There is no question when an adult female is ovulating. It is as obvious as the bright pink cauliflower on her behind. Not so for our own species. Given the great importance, socially, biologically, evolutionarily, of reproduction, and thus of ovulation, it is extraordinary and as yet unexplained why even now, in our medically sophisticated 21st century, it is exceedingly difficult to tell something so basic as when a woman is fertile. For reasons unknown, human beings conceal their ovulation and are unique among mammals in doing so. Not only that, but in the great majority of cases, the exact time of a woman's ovulation is even hidden from herself. As with menstruation and non-lactating breasts, hypotheses abound, but no one knows the answer. Ditto for female orgasm. Its male counterpart is a no-brainer, almost literally, since without ejaculation there would be no fatherhood and thus no evolutionary success. But the data are quite clear. There is no correlation between female orgasm and female fitness in the evolutionary sense. In other words, orgasmic women are no more successful reproductively than their less fortunate non-orgasmic sisters. So why does female orgasm occur at all? Proceeding along in the trajectory of a woman's life, we come to yet another mystery, menopause. By around age 50, a woman can anticipate that she will cease ovulating. Why does reproduction inevitably end, even for the healthiest women, at a time in middle age when many can anticipate several decades of continued and vigorous life? This is especially perplexing since reproductive success is the name of the Darwinian game, and simple calculations show that producing just one additional child compounded over time would convey a huge evolutionary advantage. Yet menopause is not only a cross-cultural human universal, but also one not shared by any other living thing, except possibly for the short-finned pilot whale. But of course, you already knew that. Let's consider these mysteries and some possible solutions one at a time. A signal? It has been suggested that all mammals may in fact shed some of their uterine lining between ovulations, but no other species comes close to Homo sapiens in the volume of blood flow and amount of tissue disruption which requires women to literally rebuild their uterine lining with each reproductive cycle. The amount of blood loss, about 40 milliliters, is not enormous, but is enough to force many to take iron supplements. It is as though every sexually competent woman is obliged to suffer an automatic monthly deduction from her metabolic checking account. Not only that, but it seems likely that the shedding of fresh blood, sometimes in copious quantities, would make menstruating women more susceptible to predators, many of which are exquisitely sensitive to cues that indicate potential prey. Given that evolution is a stern taskmistress, constantly sifting and sorting through alternatives to find the most efficient and fitness-enhancing way to accomplish the various tasks of living, why have we signed on to such expensive and possibly even risky monthly taxation? And this doesn't even count the cramps, which in some cases are so severe as to be temporarily disabling. One might even say that menstruation almost literally deserves its old-fashioned descriptor, the curse. More scientifically, we would expect that women who did not menstruate would have been more successful over evolutionary time than those who did. Yet the opposite has clearly been true, since menstruation is something that all healthy premenopausal women do. It may be an annoyance, but it is not an illness or a biomedical problem. Rather, prolonged amenorrhea, failure to menstruate, indicates that something is wrong. In addition, about 10% of otherwise healthy women suffer from endometriosis, a painful and potentially life-threatening condition caused when cells of the uterine lining are discharged in the wrong direction, into the pelvic cavity instead of outside the body. And of course, menstruation necessitates that for a particular duration, typically 3 to 5 days, pregnancy cannot occur. This is yet another cost of menstruation, which further italicizes the mystery that it exists at all. For starters, let's ignore the suggestion, repeated through generations of folk wisdom, that menstruation indicates the weeping of a disappointed uterus that has failed its reproductive role. This notion is especially foolish since the likelihood is that without menstruation, more cycles would be successful. Ditto for the theological assertion that it constitutes part of the punishment inflicted by a vengeful deity upon a disobedient Eve. There are, in fact, several possible scientific hypotheses for menstruation. For one, it could be a signal by which a woman's body tells her brain that she isn't pregnant. After all, that is how menstruation is used today, just as, conversely, a failure to get one's period is an early signal that a woman may be pregnant. It would clearly be advantageous for a woman to know her reproductive status, and in a world before pregnancy test kits, it is quite likely that by its presence or absence, menstruation gave the first clue. Fair enough, but logically unlikely. Why should natural selection have favored such an expensive, all-clear signal, especially one that had to be broadcast each month? Wouldn't it have been far more efficient, and not at all beyond the reach of evolution, to endow pregnant women with a distinctive smell, a unique sneeze, or the rapid blinking of their left eye? It seems like blatant overkill to lose much of your physical self, your uterine lining, just to send the message that you are not pregnant. And even if menstruation serves such a signaling function, why isn't it simply a bit of spotting, as in dogs? The copiousness of human menstrual bleeding nonetheless suggests that maybe it's a social signal, a message intended for others. In many human societies today, the onset of menses indicates the beginning of adulthood. So maybe menstruation, for all its drawbacks, was selected as a way of informing one's surrounding social network that a girl is becoming a woman and should be taken seriously. One problem with this hypothesis is that such signaling appears more likely to be disadvantageous to the signaler. Even though biologists are agreed that male-male competition is typically more vigorous, even violent, than its female-female counterpart, it is increasingly clear that female-female competition also occurs. More subtle than the male-male version, it nonetheless involves situations in which dominant adult females of a number of species actually attack, intimidate, and often inhibit the breeding of subordinates. Assuming that something comparable occurs in our own species, admittedly an unproven assumption at present, it would seem to behoove a young woman to, if anything, hide the fact that she is entering reproductive competence, especially since such a signaler would necessarily be young and thus liable to be particularly vulnerable. The possibility still exists, although a slim one, that menstrual bleeding is not targeted at other women generally, but more specifically aimed at close relatives and others who might be primed to cooperate rather than compete to render useful assistance to a younger kinswoman once they know of her change in reproductive status. It would be interesting to see if menstrual flow is in any way correlated with presence or absence of potential competitors on the one hand or helpers on the other. At present, however, it is hard to see how menstruation could have evolved as a social signal, especially given that in nearly all human societies today, it is considered awkward, embarrassing, even shameful, the body conveying information that one's mind would prefer to keep under wraps. A signaling hypothesis for menstruation could still be salvaged, however, if it were directed toward men. But if so, the earlier question repeats itself. Why use such an expensive signaling system instead of, say, employing pheromones? After all, males are sperm makers by definition, and because sperm are cheap and abundant, sperm makers are selected to be highly attuned to indications of fertility on the part of prospective partners. It is interesting, nonetheless, that in the modern Western world at least, substantial effort is expended to hide the fact of menstruation, which itself paradoxically suggests that in the absence of the feminine hygiene industry and its constant efforts to provide women with protection from their own bodies, enabling them to hide, suppress, tiptoe around, or otherwise obscure the reality of menstruation, maybe it really did evolve as a signal. In the past, it was certainly widely noticed, although generally misunderstood. Nothing could easily be found that is more remarkable than the monthly flux of women, wrote Pliny the Elder 2 millennia ago. Contact with it turns new wine sour, crops touched by it become barren, grafts die, seeds in gardens are dried up, the fruits of trees fall off, the bright surface of mirrors in which it is merely reflected is dimmed, the edge of steel and the gleam of ivory are dulled, hives of bees die, even bronze and iron are at once seized by rust, and a horrible smell fills the air. Demeaning and inaccurate as such attention has been, if nothing else, it encourages us to look for other explanations. The cleansing hypothesis. Here is one. What if menstruation serves a cleansing function, using periodic blood flow to sluice away potentially dangerous pathogens, including, but not limited to, those introduced during copulation? This explanation has pros and cons, like nearly all the perplexities to be considered in the present book, and like most, it has generated fruitful debate. Moreover, it's a nifty idea, not least because it reverses the old canard that menstruating women are somehow unclean, or that the phenomenon is a reflection of female weakness, emphasizing instead that the exact opposite is more likely the case. Sperm plus semen are actually more likely to be unclean, not to mention possible pathogens introduced during coitus itself, with menstruation conceivably being a hygienic and even heroic countermeasure. The reality, of course, is that ovaries and the uterus are internal organs, abundantly outfitted with delicate tissue that is vulnerable to infection, and sexual intercourse necessarily involves introducing foreign material deep inside a woman's body, bypassing most of her traditional defenses. Certain pathogens, such as chlamydia, a common cause of pelvic inflammatory disease, hitchhike on the tails of sperm, and bacteria such as staphylococcus and streptococcus, which cause no harm when inhabiting the vagina, can be serious troublemakers when transported via an enthusiastic penis into a woman's upper reproductive tract. Margie Prophet, who developed the cleansing hypothesis, emphasized that the uterus is designed to bleed via its specialized spiral-shaped arteries and arterioles. When these constrict, the uterine lining dies and is sloughed off, presumably taking any unwanted pathogenic invaders along with it. In addition, the resulting copious blood flow essentially hoses down the underlying uterine wall. Prophet also pointed out that menstrual blood contains a concentration of leukocytes that is about 3 times higher than normal blood. These white blood cells, brought directly into contact with the uterus, are thus made available to fight any infections. There are practical implications of the cleansing hypothesis. If, as the hypothesis holds, menstrual bleeding is an adaptive response to infection or potential infection, then it is clearly normal. What about unusually heavy bleeding? Menorrhagia or intracyclic bleeding, metrorrhagia. These could be symptoms of endometritis, inflammation of the uterine lining, or they could be part of a body's attempt to fight off such infections. Prophet, arguing for menstruation's cleansing role, points out that assuming the former, and therefore using medications to inhibit such bleeding, would be equivalent to blaming firemen for a fire. Convincing as it might be at first blush, the cleansing hypothesis also has problems. Menstrual blood contains nutrients, especially iron, that might actually encourage pathogen growth. And in fact, many pathogens are specifically iron-deprived, such that surrounding them with blood might provide them with just the nutrients they need. There is also no evidence that menstrual intensity, either in human beings or animals, correlates with pathogen load, which would be predicted. Under the cleansing hypothesis, an already clean uterus would be expected to correlate with less tissue loss and reduced blood flow. Were this the case, it would doubtless have been trumpeted by devotees of the cleansing hypothesis as evidence in its favor, so the opposite finding must be acknowledged as evidence against. Suppose, alternatively, that pathogen invasion is difficult for the uterus to detect, which might in turn prevent adaptive modulation of the cleansing response. In fact, insofar as bodies are able to respond to pathogens by killing them, selection would have favored discrete invaders that gave minimal indications of their presence. Even then, however, another correlation could be expected. Between sexual activity, either number of partners or frequency of coitus with the same partner, and menstruation. But the reality, once again, is not encouraging. Although some women have relatively heavy menstrual flows and some much lighter, menstrual intensity also does not vary with the number of different sexual partners or with the nature and frequency of sexual encounters, another strike against the cleansing hypothesis. Also, if menstruation serves to diminish the uterus's pathogen load, either by flushing them away or zapping them with white blood cells, then there should be fewer bacteria present after menstruation than before. It is notoriously difficult to assess total bacteria load in a given human organ. However, it is relatively easy to determine how many different kinds of bacteria are present, and when this is done, the evidence points the opposite way: more bacterial diversity after menstruation than before. There is yet more evidence against the cleansing hypothesis. It is well established that women in traditional, non-technological societies enter menarche later and spend more time pregnant and nursing than do Western women. As a result, they experience far fewer menstrual cycles than do Western women, and therefore, according to the cleansing hypothesis, they should be more susceptible to uterine infections. There is no evidence for this. The cleansing hypothesis would also expect that women with an especially heavy menstrual flow would have a lower frequency of pelvic inflammatory disease. This has not yet been evaluated. It is also problematic that oral contraceptives, which substantially decrease menstrual blood volume, do not increase the risk of uterine infection, even though it could be argued that such contraceptive use is balanced by a possible increase in heterosexual activity, which is typically why the contraceptives are used in the first place. The efficiency hypothesis. There is another possible explanation for why menstruation evolved based on energy efficiency. Calculations suggest that it is metabolically cheaper to slough off the uterine lining, which is energetically expensive to maintain, and then regrow it in preparation for the next cycle of ovulation, than to maintain it in a high level of vascularization. In support of this idea, anthropologist Beverly Strassman noted that a post-menstrual uterus consumes only about 14% of the oxygen required by a fully prepared endometrium. Not only that, but a woman's overall metabolic rate during the pre-ovulatory follicular phase of her cycle, when the uterine lining is regressed, is about 7% lower than during the secretory luteal phase, when it is actively growing. Efficiency is a less than exciting notion, but after all, energy is the basic currency of life, making it not unreasonable that a woman's metabolic economy alternately revs up and down, economizing on the costs of remaining ready to reproduce. The idea is that unlike, say, the lungs or heart, a woman can afford to down-regulate the activity within her uterus, keeping it at a slow idle during those times between ovulations when reproduction is not an option. On the other hand, the metabolic efficiency hypothesis is not entirely convincing. Why, for instance, isn't the uterus simply kept in a more efficient, low-energy, less vascularized state until needed for nourishing an embryo? That is, why build up a fancy and expensive uterine lining ready to receive an implanting embryo, only to tear it down every month? Why not just tamp down the endometrium and keep it quiescent until an embryo comes along? That would be more efficient yet. Part of menstruation's enigma, and the need for all these hypotheses, is that it poses a kind of Sisyphean dilemma. According to Greek mythology, Sisyphus was condemned to spend eternity pushing a heavy rock up a steep hill, only to have it roll back down each time. A menstruating woman finds herself constructing a snazzy, energetically expensive endometrium each month, only to dislodge it again and again. Sisyphus had no choice, ditto for most women. But presumably, evolution did. A competence test? An alternative explanation is what I have dubbed the evaluation hypothesis, which derives from the fact that human beings are unique among mammals in how much they invest in each offspring. This makes it especially important that any embryo that is brought to term be an especially capable one. After pregnancy and childbirth comes lactation, followed by years, even decades, of continuing expenditure on behalf of human offspring, spending time and energy, running risks, and so forth. It may therefore be significant that for every successful pregnancy, there are many spontaneous abortions caused by the failure of an early embryo to implant successfully. For anyone with a scientific mindset and who therefore believes that all phenomena have causes, the very word spontaneous should set off alarm bells. Maybe in this case, a spontaneous abortion really means that the embryo or fetus was tried and found wanting, or at least not deserving of further maternal investment. And maybe the events surrounding menstruation are how a woman's body evaluates her would-be offspring and does so early in the investment cycle, thereby minimizing wasted investment in case of a thumbs down. A key aspect of early pregnancy takes place when an embryo, really just a fertilized zygote, begins burrowing into the uterine lining and starts secreting a hormone, human chorionic gonadotropin, or HCG, that inhibits menstruation. Early in a woman's menstrual cycle, luteinizing hormone, produced by the brain, not only kickstarts ovulation, it also keeps a woman's ovaries making its own hormone, progesterone, which in turn keeps the uterine lining in place. If no pregnancy occurs, luteinizing hormone levels decline, which in turn causes a precipitous drop-off in progesterone, which results in the breakdown of the uterine lining and, shortly thereafter, menstruation. Let's consider, therefore, that menstruation, rather than signaling no pregnancy, is a way of ensuring its absence. But of course, evolution shouldn't promote non-reproduction, except perhaps in a species such as Homo sapiens, whose investment in offspring is so great that it pays to establish a kind of competence test, making sure that any would-be fetus and eventual child is sufficiently sturdy to warrant all that expenditure of time and energy and running of risks that are to come. To ward off menstruation, the newly implanted embryo has to substitute its own HCG for the luteinizing hormone produced by the mother. Molecule for molecule, HCG is more potent than luteinizing hormone, and it actually causes an increase in progesterone levels, which in turn prevents menstruation and maintains the uterus as a rich and warmly receptive receiving blanket for the embryo. The foregoing leads toward a hypothesis whereby menstruation is part of a regularly repeating competence test. Because HCG is a very large molecule, it cannot pass directly into the mother's body by crossing her cell membranes. It must be secreted directly into her blood. As a result, a human embryo cannot guarantee its survival by simply secreting HCG. It has to get to the endometrium and dig itself in. This big dig isn't easy, which might be exactly the point. The process of implantation in human beings is more invasive and thus more difficult than in other mammals, consisting of a delicate dance between receptive maternal tissues and a capable embryo. In the earliest stages of pregnancy, it's the embryo that does nearly all the work, struggling to get itself deeply enmeshed in uterine tissue so that it can eventually get nourishment, but first so that it can secrete HCG to prevent menstruation. If so, the menstruation is a sword held over the head of the as-yet headless embryo. Implantation itself is a kind of Rubicon. Once crossed, the mother is committed to ongoing investment, and lots of it. This, in turn, may have selected for the mother ensuring that any inadequate early embryos can be weeded out quickly and painlessly. To summarize, perhaps menstruation is essentially a regularly repeating competence test, whereby evolution selects against embryos whose burrowing and secretory abilities are inadequate. Unfortunately for this hypothesis, however, it makes a prediction identical to the cleansing hypothesis, and one that is not supported by reality. Menstruation should be tied to sexual activity. Also, if people have been selected to menstruate as a means of subjecting their embryos to competence testing, then why isn't this the case for other species, for whom each offspring also represents a major commitment? Why don't elephants menstruate, or blue whales, or manatees? It's a mystery. Period. Concealed ovulation, an evolutionary shell game? Most female mammals are altogether above board when their eggs are ripe and ready to encounter a suitable sperm. In addition to signs of genital swelling, they typically emit characteristic pheromones, and their behavior changes as well. Not so for our own species. Actually, there is growing evidence that women do, in fact, exhibit subtle behavioral cues as to their ovulatory status, but the key here is subtle. It is only in recent years that these indications have been discovered. If they constituted what scientists call a robust phenomenon, everyone would have known about them long ago. The surprising reality is that very few people can tell, and no one with certainty, when their neighbor, friend, relative, lover, or wife is about to ovulate. Not only that, but most women cannot even tell when or if they will do so themselves. To some degree, ovulation can be detected by a very small rise in body temperature, as well as changes in the consistency of the vaginal mucus, but both assessments are difficult and unreliable. Indeed, the fact that such careful ascertainment must be exercised only further italicizes the extent to which it is not obvious. Even now, we have no reliable rhythm method of non-contraceptive birth control, which is to say, no easy way to know when women are ovulating. Pharmaceutical companies make huge amounts of money marketing test kits that provide anxious women the same information that most mammals get for free. Concealed ovulation, therefore, is a mystery squared. Not only is the timing of human ovulation hidden, and thus a mystery in itself, but furthermore, it is a mystery why it is such a mystery. It is, of course, possible that concealed human ovulation hasn't been actively selected for, but rather that shout-out-loud technicolor ovulation a la chimpanzees is the derived condition, and thus the one that needs explaining, with inconspicuousness as found among Homo sapiens being the evolutionarily irrelevant default state. This is unlikely for several reasons. Start with the fact that nearly all mammals, including our closest relatives, the chimps and bonobos, announce their ovulation, which itself is strong presumptive evidence that our ancestors, too, were relatively uninhibited about drawing attention to their ovulatory status. Beyond this, there is essentially no variability with regard to concealed ovulation in our species. If natural selection were indifferent to whether human ovulation was hidden or advertised, then we would expect substantial variability, since public ovulators, concealed ovulators, and in-betweeners would all be pretty much equally fit and thus equally abundant. There is, for example, substantial variability in human skin color, eye color, blood type, and so forth, all traits about which natural selection is evidently more or less indifferent. But there are no women whose ovulation is even remotely like a chimpanzee's. The likelihood, therefore, is that human ovulation isn't just neutral or subtle, but that it is actively hidden. Yet a moment's thought suggests that if nothing else, any woman who knows when she is fertile, whether or not she informs others, should be better equipped to become pregnant, or avoid pregnancy, or choose her offspring's father, than would someone who hasn't a clue and doesn't give any. Earlier, when considering menstruation, we considered and, for the most part, rejected the idea that it might have evolved as a social signal. Could the same be true, but reversed, for concealed ovulation? What of the prospect that human ovulation is concealed as a way of suppressing a social signal? It is, pardon the expression, conceivable. Thus, it could be argued that by concealing ovulation, our early hominid ancestors obscure their reproductive status, thereby limiting possible aggressive competition from other, more dominant women. Consistent with this idea, there is growing evidence that, contrary to the generalizations still popular in evolutionary biology about the exclusive maleness of same-sex competition, females generally, and women in particular, do in fact compete, albeit more subtly than via the chest-beating, fangs-bared style, more characteristic of males. Hence, it might well have contributed to a woman's ultimate evolutionary success if she kept her reproductive status under wraps, almost literally. This seems a plausible hypothesis, except that it would be stronger if ovulation were more concealed among women living in more densely interactive social environments and comparatively unobscured when the woman in question was the only show in town. This isn't the case. Similarly, this hypothesis would be more convincing if younger, less dominant women concealed their ovulation, while older, more socially and physically secure women flaunted theirs. But they don't. It is reasonable to hypothesize that concealed ovulation is essentially an evolutionary shell game, whereby women who hid their time of maximum fertility kept their men in a kind of sexual thrall. Among species in which ovulation is clearly signaled, males are free to copulate at this time, then essentially abandon their inamorata, often in search of other short-term partners. Such, for example, is the notorious sex life of chimps and bonobos. But in Homo sapiens, in which ovulation is concealed, men wanting confidence of paternity are obliged to remain in attendance throughout the female cycle, engaging in regular sexual relations during the month. A study examining 68 different primate species, looking for correlations between mating system and visible signs of estrus, found that not a single monogamous species was a conspicuous ovulator. Human beings are also unusual among living things, not just primates, in the extent to which they copulate without much regard to ovulation or the details of a woman's hormonal condition. This further suggests that concealed ovulation may have evolved as a tactic whereby our great-great-great-grandmothers made sure that our great-great-great-grandfathers kept close tabs on them instead of, or in spite of, lusting after someone else. One of Homo sapiens' signature characteristics is our long period of infancy and childhood dependency, which is why even today, single parenting is difficult. It therefore makes sense that having a devoted mate would enhance the fitness of the woman in question, even if said devotion is purchased via a kind of sexual hostage-taking, playing to his unconscious uncertainty rather than his love. It is certainly possible that if women were more chimp-like, men would be too, copulating avidly with a given partner while she is fertile, but then seeking other and equally alluring partnerships, bolstered by an unconscious confidence that his prior mate would not cuckold him in the meanwhile, since she obviously is incapable of conceiving. In addition, it is interesting to speculate that by inducing men to keep close company with a given woman, concealed ovulation contributed to making them fathers, and not just sperm donors, since one result of all that mate guarding, as biologists term it, would be greater male confidence that their offspring, or rather their female partner's offspring, are in fact theirs, too. But such speculation, compelling as it may be, doesn't prove anything. For instance, the keep him close by keeping him uncertain hypothesis assumes that regular sex is a prerequisite for social bonding and biparental behavior, yet there are numerous bird species and even some primates, for example gibbons, that commonly go long periods without sexual intercourse and are nonetheless socially monogamous, and some that copulate rarely yet demonstrate notably shared parental duties, for example pygmy marmosets, in which fathers carry infants and even reportedly assist with the birthing process. Most of us know people who stay devoted to each other, even though the sexual spark may be only intermittent, if not altogether extinguished. And on the other side, human marriages can fail despite intense and satisfying sexual chemistry. Sometimes, indeed, this is the only thing that works in a relationship, and if so, it's rarely enough. Taking control and increasing the options. In fact, there is another possible explanation for concealed ovulation that goes precisely against the grain of the shell game, or keeping him guessing to keep him close, explanations. Rather than promoting social and sexual bonding, cynics might say bondage, ovulation might be hidden in our species because such obscurantism makes it easier for women to have sex with men other than their designated partner. After all, given that women don't identify the precise time of ovulation, even the most dedicated man would likely have a hard time guarding his woman so closely as to be able to monopolize her sex life, something that would presumably be more possible if her fertile times were clearly signaled, as in so many other primates. By obscuring their exact ovulation, ancestral women might therefore have actually given themselves more leeway to mate with other, more attractive males when and if they chose. In addition to providing women with greater potential choice of mates, concealed ovulation may have yielded a counterintuitive evolutionary payoff by enabling them to mate with males who might otherwise be potential murderers of their offspring. It is now well established that among many social species, including presumably our own ancestors, strange adult males were a major threat to the survival of infants. This is because after taking over a social unit, male longer monkeys, chimpanzees, gorillas, lions, and so forth, often kill lactating infants, which had been sired by their predecessor. Why such carnage? Two reasons. First, these infants had been sired by the previous male, so the new harem tyrant has no genetic interest in preserving them. And second, by killing their suckling babes, a newly ascendant male induces nursing mothers to begin cycling once again, thereby making these females potential recipients of the murderous male's sexual attention and eventually contributing to his reproductive success. Not a pretty picture, especially for the victimized infants and their mothers. But the latter might have a few tricks of their own, including perhaps one inherited by our ancestors. Typically, newly ascendant males spare the offspring of females with whom they had previously copulated, as though they say to themselves, "Isn't that my old flame from several months ago? And just look at that cute little baby. He's got my chin." It has been suggested, in short, that female choice of multiple male sexual partners, itself facilitated by concealed ovulation, may be a means whereby our great-great-great-grandmothers fooled the men in their lives, inducing several to think that each might be the father, and thereby taking out a kind of infanticide insurance. Here is a related but more cheery hypothesis for why human ovulation is concealed, focusing on benefits to the woman, ultimately via payoffs to her offspring. It is clearly advantageous to every woman to be fertilized by the best available sperm, which unfortunately might not be provided by her mate slash husband. Sadly, the real world of potential sexual and social partners is not like Lake Wobegon, where all the women are strong, all the men are good-looking, and all the children are above average. The average mate of the average woman is, well, average. Since a would-be mother is more likely to be reproductively successful mated to a less-than-perfect male specimen than if she were unmated, she might therefore be predisposed, which is to say favored by natural selection, to increase her fitness by sticking with her partner, who presumably is the best she is able to obtain, while also trying to have sex with more attractive men on the sly. The assumption here is that attractiveness, which is very much in the eye of the beholder, is likely to be determined by whether the person in question has traits that signal higher fitness to be experienced by his potential offspring, either unusually healthy, for example, or simply possessing traits that, once manifested in their sons, would likely be found attractive by the next generation of women. The possibility therefore exists that by concealing their ovulation, ancestral women were able to obtain desirable genes, as well as perhaps other immediate material resources, from desirable men with whom they mated adulterously, while also retaining paternal assistance from their socially designated but cuckolded partner. Another way of saying this, by dispensing with estrus, which is essentially equivalent to concealing one's ovulation, early hominid women may have been able to exercise greater control over their choice of a sexual partner. This could have worked in either of two ways. For one, insofar as concealed ovulation facilitated clandestine matings with men other than their designated mate, this needn't only have involved taking out infanticide insurance. It would also have provided the opportunity for women to engage sexually with men of their choice. And for another, consider that female mammals in heat, which is to say in estrus because they are ovulating, are typically no more rational than their male counterparts. Lacking estrus, that is, having concealed their ovulation, women can remain comparatively cool and in sexual control, at least compared to other mammals. By foregoing estrus, this particular argument goes, women have become masters of their genetic fate, empowered to pick and choose, deciding, maybe not consciously, but by exercising a degree of judgment nonetheless, among potential suitors. After all, the word estrus comes from a Greek term for a parasitic fly that pursues cattle and drives them crazy. A female animal in estrus seems more than a little crazy. By the same token, females who are not in estrus, which is to say all women all the time, are more likely to be sane, sober, and capable of better judgment. In his poem, If, Rudyard Kipling wrote about the merits of being able to keep your head while all those around you are losing theirs. If you can do this, according to his famous poem, then you will be a man, my son. Maybe by favoring those women able to just say no to the tyranny of estrus, natural selection endowed our female ancestors with the ability to reap the benefits of being more discriminating than any animal, and probably more so than most men to boot. If you can keep your secret, evolution might have been betting, while all those around you are divulging theirs, then you will be a reproductively successful woman, my daughter. Concealed ovulation could also have adaptively paved the way for women to enjoy greater mating control by reducing the intensity of male-male competition. Think of it this way. If women were only sexually receptive for a day or so each month, at which time they broadcast their availability by sudden, seductive signals of sight, smell, and sexual interest, men might respond by huffing and puffing and blowing each other away, even more than they do now, leaving women little choice perhaps but to accept the victor. Dominant males may be desirable sperm donors, if only because their sons may also turn out to be dominant and/or desirable males. This is the so-called sexy son hypothesis, about which more later. But such males may also be terrible fathers, more interested in beating other males over the head than in caring for their own children. By keeping their ovulation secret, and thereby dampening the competitive ardor of men, women might have given themselves the opportunity of choosing men who may be less pushy but more paternal. At this point, it is worth noting that even though women neither broadcast dramatic ovulatory messages like chimpanzees, nor behave in a manner commensurate with estrus in other animals, research has shown that women's behavior does indeed undergo subtle but substantial changes during their menstrual cycle. When they are ovulating, women are especially likely to wear clothing that is comparatively sexy and reveals more skin, to speak with greater fluency and creativity, to prefer images of men who are especially manly, as well as favoring male voices that are lower pitched, to be perceived by both men and women as more facially attractive, to have a heightened sense of smell, and literally to move around more. Moreover, evidence is also accumulating that men are able to perceive at least some of these changes, albeit unconsciously. Thus, in a series of renowned dirty t-shirt experiments, researchers got female college students to sleep alone wearing the same t-shirts for several days during their fertile phase, and again wearing different shirts when post-ovulatory. Young men were then presented with these pairs of shirts, each worn by the same woman but at different reproductive phases. Sure enough, they preferred the ones worn during the follicular phase, just prior to ovulation, in 75% of the cases. In addition, when the women had been taking hormonal contraceptives which suppress ovulation, this preference disappeared. Most dramatic are some findings involving lap dancers. A number of these hardworking women were asked to keep track of two things: their ovulatory cycles and how much money they made on tips while dancing on any given night. The results were staggering, even for people who might have anticipated an effect. During a 5-hour shift while maximally fertile, the women averaged $355, when in the luteal phase, so-so fertility, they brought in $260, and while menstruating, they made a paltry $185. Perhaps these women were sending pheromonal signals to which their male customers were unconsciously responding, or perhaps they unintentionally behaved more sexily as a function of their fertility. Either way, they were doing something different, and men were responding. Evidence of this sort has led biologist Randy Thornhill and psychologist Stephen Gangestad to claim that women do in fact experience genuine estrus like other mammals. I am dubious, if only because typical mammalian estrus is so obvious that it calls to mind the comment made to someone considering purchase of a Rolls Royce: if you have to ask how much it costs, you can't afford it. If you have to debate whether estrus is occurring, it isn't. On the other hand, although human ovulation is concealed from our conscious awareness, this doesn't mean that it is totally 100% hidden. Perhaps we should talk about an oxymoronic cryptic estrus, or some neologism. In any event, recent findings that women show a sexually and evolutionarily consistent suite of behavior when they are most fertile comports nicely with the keeping control hypothesis described earlier, in that ironically, by concealing their ovulation, even as fertility is influencing their behavior, women might succeed in keeping control without being aware of the control that they are exercising. As a general rule, male animals trade resources for sex, whereas females trade sex for resources. Imagine a prehistoric hominid woman who, like females of many different species, is prepared to exchange sex in return, let's say, for food. If chimp-like, she made it anatomically obvious when she was fertile, it would also be clear when she wasn't, and as a result, she might have lost some leverage otherwise available. The male might well be uninterested, unless her anatomy or pheromones made her interesting. Such a female might then find herself forced to have sex with him, thereby possibly getting his genes, when all she really wanted was his banana. On the other hand, if she didn't give obvious cues as to whether or not she was fertile, Our same great-great-great-grandmother could get the banana and eat it, too. And even if she had to comply sexually as part of the deal, she wouldn't necessarily be committing her precious eggs into the bargain. Sexual liberation? It may seem paradoxical, but by losing full-blown estrus, women may also have set the stage for having more sex, not less. Estrus-based sex is largely, if not entirely, reproductive. By severing the link between sexual intercourse and fertilization, or at least obscuring that link, concealed ovulation provides opportunities for non-reproductive sex. This, in turn, might be part of the biological reason for concealed ovulation, if it enables couples to bond together especially tightly to express and enhance their love via liberated sex. But we might ask, why are sex and love so tightly connected? Why don't romantic partners express and enhance their love by picking each other's lice? Many primates do just that, or via beautifully coordinated, mutually satisfying bouts of highly choreographed hiccupping. One guess is that people find shared sex reinforcing to the pair bond for a particular reason. Hints of why can be glimpsed in other species. Look at it this way. Why do people, and certain other animals, copulate so often? The answer may seem distressingly practical, even cynical. When we look at those other species that have frequent sex, some even more often than human beings, we find that many, bonobos, chimpanzees, some species of dolphins and lions excepted, are socially monogamous but prone to being sexually unfaithful. Certain birds, for example goshawks, osprey, white ibises, and acorn woodpeckers, copulate hundreds of times for every clutch of eggs, and they don't limit those copulations to their designated partners. The possible connection is as follows. When males are separated from their mates for a substantial part of each day, they risk having their female partners copulate with someone else, after which they could end up rearing another male's offspring. The sexually adventurous female, by contrast, would be risking little. After all, she is guaranteed to be the mother of her offspring, no matter how many partners she may have. But the male, by contrast, has no such automatic confidence. Mommy's babies, daddy's maybes. Accordingly, males who spend substantial time away from their female partners may be especially inclined to copulate frequently when they are at home, to increase the chances that their offspring are in fact theirs. We might conclude that they love their mates all the more when given the opportunity to make love with them. Moreover, the more loving they do, the more love they feel, with love in such cases defined as a powerful inclination to remain with and be devoted to one's partner. In biological terms, the greater is the confidence of shared genetic investment, the greater is the love. Now let's take the female's perspective and say that the lady osprey, goshawk, or white ibis is occasionally inclined to have sex with males in addition to her mate, perhaps because her extracurricular partner is particularly able or inclined to invest in her offspring, or because his genes are especially fitness-enhancing. At the same time, however, she dearly wants to retain the parental assistance of her social mate. It would make sense in such cases for the female to indulge her social partner's sexual inclinations and to copulate often, if only because by assuaging his unconscious anxieties, she is more likely to obtain his continuing assistance and commitment while still remaining free to indulge her own extra pair inclinations when her mate isn't around. Maybe all this has nothing to do with human beings, but it is probably no coincidence that other species among which pairs copulate frequently are particularly likely to do so outside the pair bond as well. The prospect looms, therefore, that the remarkably high frequency of in-pair human sex isn't so remarkable after all, considering that human beings are more than a little prone to sexual dalliance. So perhaps we don't advertise our ovulation, at least in part, because to do so would be to invite an unacceptably high level of sexual jealousy and obsessive male guarding on the part of the male at these times. This would be all the more biologically awkward for females in proportion if they are somewhat inclined to infidelity, which they are. Women would accordingly be more fit if they didn't incite their social mates to keep too close tabs on their sexual activities. Lacking a powerful peak of sexual desire and of desirability, women would also have been liberated to have sex with other males and not just their designated mates. This possibility is a variant on the earlier notion of keeping control by keeping him guessing, and it emphasizes the sexual liberation of women, but it differs in paying attention to each woman's payoff. Benefits that needn't involve purchasing infanticide insurance or even sire choice, but rather covering her tracks. Not only that, but such liberation might also free a woman to have abundant sex with her designated partner as well, in the process keeping him sexually satisfied and also less worried about his paternity, perhaps less worried than he ought to be. Had enough? For better or worse, those suggestions do not exhaust the many possible explanations for concealed ovulation. It has been suggested, for example, that concealed ovulation has been selected for as a means of keeping the peace. Imagine, if you will, the situation in an otherwise staid commercial office, university, or bank, or a Pleistocene campfire or Ice Age cave, for that matter, if the women regularly underwent a dramatic and readily apparent transition each month when they became fertile. The resulting chaos and heightened competition might well be so disadvantageous as to give an advantage to those women whose reproductive status remained demurely incognito. This may seem compelling, but actually it is not persuasive to most evolutionary biologists, for the simple reason that under such conditions, any benefit derived by a concealed ovulator would be shared by everyone, including those whose reproductive status was public. On the other hand, if the payoff of concealing one's ovulation rests upon keeping the peace, then presumably those who weren't thus concealed would have gained something by going public, and yet they would be the only ones to profit as a result, while the costs of chaos would largely extend to everyone. Therefore, although concealing one's ovulation might have benefited society as a whole, it is difficult to see how it would have been selected for at the level of individuals and their genes, which is pretty much the only way natural selection works. Self-deception and the headache hypothesis. There is yet another important hypothesis that remains to be considered. It is especially intriguing for several reasons. For one, it brings in a seemingly independent evolutionary mystery, namely, consciousness. For another, it confronts one of the enduring puzzles about concealed ovulation. It is one thing for ovulation to be hidden from others, but why, in Darwin's name, should such important, biologically crucial information be kept from the woman herself? Why is this such a deep, dark secret, one that cannot even be shared with a person who presumably has, if not a legal or moral right to the information, at least a deep personal stake in obtaining it? And finally, this last hypothesis is somewhat counterintuitive and therefore great fun to examine. It was first suggested by Nancy Burley, an evolutionary biologist currently at the University of California, Irvine. Let's assume that far enough back in the human evolutionary line, there was a range of self-awareness when it came to one's own ovulation, as there is for most things. Some women could tell when they were fertile, others, at the other extreme of the distribution, had little or no idea, and in between there was a range of ovulatory self-consciousness. Add to this the fact that among many traditional peoples today, hunter-gatherers and other members of non-technological societies, women want fewer children than men do, mostly because of the downsides of pregnancy and childbirth, especially in an environment lacking biomedical sophistication. The result is the following prospect. If, like today's hunter-gatherers, our ancestral grandmothers disagreed with their mates in wanting fewer offspring, then those who detected their own time of the month might well have made special efforts at those times to fend off the advances of our would-be ancestral grandfathers. Call it the headache hypothesis. By succeeding in limiting their reproduction, such women would unknowingly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.